In 1965, an engineer predicted that we'd be able to double the processing power of computers every 2 years. And he was right. Since then, we've been pretty much following this trend called Moore's Law. Computing power has grown exponentially, forming the backbone of much of modern life. But Moore's Law is breaking down. To make computers better, we've been filling them with more and more transistors, which are what create the ones and zeros that make computers work. Transistors have now shrunk to the size of one atom. Beyond that, there's nowhere to go, because the laws of physics get weird. A completely different sector where we're also hitting a wall is solar power. Current panels can only turn around a quarter of sunlight into energy, and we can't make them more efficient. The reason for both is silicon, possibly the most important element of our time. It's the basis for nearly all electronics and the reason we have widespread solar power. It's also where the famous high-tech California area got its name. But even though silicon has brought us this far, it can't take us any further. These things aren't getting more efficient. So why are we outgrowing silicon? And what's next?
This is pure silicon, but most of it naturally occurs as silicon dioxide, or silica. One of the places that you'll find it is in regular old sand.
For solar panels and electronics, silica is heated and refined to over 99% purity because that pure silicon has a particular electrical property.
It's a semiconductor, so in contrast with a conductor like copper that conduct electricity easily, or an insulator like wood which won't conduct electricity at all.
Kylie Catchpole researches solar cell technology and integrating solar power into the grid.
You need a semiconductor where you can control how it conducts electricity.
In very simple terms, a semiconductor is like a switch. We can kind of turn the energy flow on and off. Even though silicon isn't the best semiconductor, it's quite a good one. And since there's a ton of it, it's cheap. For all these reasons, we've been using it for these two technologies for decades. 1884 saw the first solar panel installed on a New York City rooftop. And in the 1950s, we started making them from silicon. Back then, the panels converted around 6% of the sunlight into energy and were expensive. Since then, efficiency has gone up to around 25%, and prices have come way down. Solar is now one of the cheapest forms of energy there is. Solar panels are made of silicon treated with other elements to form differently charged layers. These layers allow current to flow in one direction.
If we have the electron moving is an electrical current, and so therefore it can go out and it can complete a circuit and it can power things.
Just like in solar panels, the silicon in computers also has these layers.
One of the places you can find those silicon layers inside a computer is a type of microchip called a CPU, or central processing unit. I'm gonna see if I can find it in this one.
The CPU is made up of a piece of silicon covered in tiny silicon transistors. Because of those layers, transistors either allow current to flow or stop it. Flowing current creates a one, and no current creates a zero. Those ones and zeros form the basis for all computing.
But the silicon isn't only in the CPU. It's all over the inside of this computer. Basically, anything that needs to do any calculations, whether for processing or storage, is going to be using silicon.
Now, tiny microchips have billions of transistors on them. We've had to start stacking them on top of each other instead of putting them side by side. More transistors means switching from one to zero faster, which has made computing better and better. But we can't make silicon transistors any smaller.
People have reached a limitation now that they went to a limitation of one atomic size.
Saravanan Yuvaraja researches the production of wide bandgap semiconductors and their use in integrated circuits.
And as per the physics law, we cannot go below this. So if we cannot go below this, then how you can make it more efficient and how you can make it more smaller?
Instead of getting smaller, transistors need to switch faster and operate at higher voltages to be more efficient. That's something silicon doesn't do very well. Silicon's limitations are also seriously holding back how much energy we can harvest from solar power. To understand the problem, we have to go down to the subatomic level. We need to look at electrons and something called the bandgap.
The bandgap is a theoretical concept that can be thought of as two bands with a space in between. This space is how much energy is required to move an electron from the bottom band to the top band. For silicon, the band gap is 1.12 electron volts. So it requires 1.12 electron volts of energy to move an electron from here up to here, where it can actually generate electricity.
If more energy is applied, the electron goes past the next band. Then it loses energy and comes back. The extra energy turns into heat and disperses through the material. The smaller the band gap, the more energy is lost as heat. Silicon has a relatively small band gap, so it can be prone to overheating. If the electron doesn't have enough energy, it doesn't make it to the band and no electricity is generated. In solar panels, energy hits the panel in the form of sunlight. But the sun gives off many different types of light, so not all of them can be absorbed efficiently by silicon. Blue light has too much energy, and infrared light has too little energy.
So just these two facts limit the efficiency of solar cells to around 30%. The record efficiency for silicon is already 26%.
This narrow band gap also wastes energy in transistors.
When you have a very small band gap, you apply one voltage and you allow the charges to move. But when electrons are moving inside the material, they also dissipate more heat. So this heat cannot be handled by silicon itself.
So do we tell tech companies to start repainting their signs? Because that efficiency problem is solvable by materials with wide band gaps. For electronics, those include gallium nitride, graphene, silicon carbide, and gallium oxides. They allow transistors to use more of their energy to perform calculations. They lose less heat and can handle over 10 times the voltage of silicon devices. They also operate at twice the maximum temperature of silicon, over 300 degrees Celsius. Because of this, wide band gap materials are already used in chargers for electric vehicles.
EV chargers and other batteries cannot be manufactured by silicon. It cannot be able to handle such amount of current naturally because of its low band gap.
It also means a computer using wide band gap semiconductors wouldn't need so much cooling, making it smaller and more energy efficient.
And they require less energy to manufacture.
Recently, we are also making some transistors or devices at a room temperature, at 25 degrees Celsius. Silicon, the minimum temperature required to manufacture devices out of it is 1000 degrees Celsius.
The materials are more expensive, which means they're not as widely available. But advances in production could change that in the near future. For solar, a promising wide bandgap material is perovskite, which can capture more of the sun's available light than silicon.
Perovskite is a crystal structure, and you can put different elements within that crystal structure, then you can tune the band gap.
That means that you can absorb more of the light, making the solar panel overall more efficient. We'll be looking at what perovskite can do for solar power in another Planet A video really soon. But efficiency isn't the only concern.
Turning that sand into silicon requires a lot of heat, and since most of the world's silicon is produced in China, most of that heat comes from burning coal.
Solar panels make up for the CO2 emissions from manufacturing. Not so with microchips, which also use a lot of water. Taiwan, one of the biggest chip manufacturers in the world, has already had to ration water in order to keep producing them. And when supply shocks like that hit, it affects the price.
After supply chains were disrupted during COVID, the price of silicon shot up. That's one of the main reasons for a chip shortage that's still continuing today.
Without silicon microchips, production of electronics and cars slowed down. And so far, there hasn't really been much recycling going on.
It's easy to see why recycling silicon from computers is hard when you look at the process of taking this one apart. I mean, just getting into it was really difficult, and I didn't even pull most of the silicon out of the components.
And we're about to face a huge challenge with solar panels.
Most of them only work well for around 25 to 30 years. And now we're starting to see many of them nearing the end of their life.
The number of used up solar panels is projected to increase to around 80 million metric tons by 2050. So we need both new materials and more sustainable silicon production and recycling. Some of that is already on the way. EU legislation requires 80% of each solar panel to be recycled at the end of its life.
The majority of panels are glass and aluminum. When they're recycled, they're basically shredded down to their components. From there, the silicon can be extracted and removed.
Silicon recycling is still in the early stages, but companies are already able to recycle around 90% of it. As of now, the silicon mostly goes to the aluminum industry, which combines it with other metals to make products. It's possible to make recycled high-purity silicon, but the purification process is expensive, energy-intensive, and not really economical at the moment. But the race is on. the silicon that has fueled the digital age has taken us as far as we can go. We need something else if we want electronics to keep getting better and solar panels to become more efficient. And although there's still a lot of work to do, why bandgap materials like perovskites, gallium nitride, and silicon carbide look to be the best options?
What should we destroy next? Let us know in the comments and don't forget to subscribe. We've got new videos every Friday. Cool.